Today, my group mates and I will be presenting a topic, Juvenile Delinquency in Singapore, and discuss whether it's an individual or societal issue. Yeah, so in this presentation, we'll each cover a reason why delinquency is a societal issue. I'll start off with reason of family, then Leon will continue to show the next reason, which is peer pressure, and then Norman will do a more broader discussion about societal living. So for my presentation, I'll be covering the familiar aspects that could possibly lead to juvenile delinquency, with parents as the main focus. So there will be two points I'll be touching on. One, parents serve as the moral compass for their children. Two, the lack of parental care and attention. And then I'll round out my part before handing the time over to Leon. So to start off, one core reason that is identified in studies is the role of parents. Why is that so? Because parents are the moral compass of children of the child's growing stages, and the presence and attention are especially important during the child's character development process. The absence of a parent in a child's growing years is proven to be detrimental. 22% of delinquents were from single parent families. And among youths who were from single parent families, there are more offenders than non-offenders. Besides having the need to be there for the child, the behavior of parents where the child is present matters too. It is similar to the point of moral compass, whereby the child will imitate the behavior of their parents. As they have not fully matured yet, the children might even imitate behaviors that are not desirable. It is observed that the child's behavior when they are older is very much linked to their formative years. So that means that when the child is exposed to violence at home, it's very likely that he or she will grow up with violent tendencies. And children are constantly exposed to violence as they grow older, and they keep this problem to themselves. It may be just a matter of time when they reach a tilting point and get overwhelmed by their pent-up emotions. The next point, with the inflationary pressures in the economy and higher standards of living, there is an increasing trend of low-income families. Sometimes parents have to work longer hours to keep up with a heavy workload. As such, families with financial means will engage the services of domestic helpers or relatives to care for the children when they are away for work. However, families with low income are not able to afford. It is important to note that the socio-economic status of youth is often related to the amount of quality or support that youth receive. A local study found that the most serious delinquents are from the lower income families where parents usually work long hours. And this is so in line with a study by the UN, whereby youth from the low income families often feel excluded and may decide to join delinquent groups to improve their status and self-esteem. Youth that fall through the cracks of society and into the trap of juvenile delinquency is usually a combination of other extrinsic factors too, like peer influence and societal labeling, should be covered more greater detail by Leon and Norman. But intrinsic factors are undeniably also reasons that lead the youth down the wayward path. Nevertheless, we need to acknowledge the role of parents is instrumental in the character and behavioral development of a child, since they are arguably the first few role models in the child's life. As such, we need to direct more attention and awareness on the important part parents play in the child's life, and that the juvenile's actions should not be blamed entirely on themselves.
Okay, on to my next point. So schools, we are no strangers to this environment, and we all know the social dynamics at play here. So who do we see the most around in schools? That's right, it's our friends. So we can all agree that friends are one of the most important people to have in school, right? Is there anyone here who can confidently say that without friends, you can have a smooth and happy school life? No? That brings me to my first point. Delinquents like us, they have a need and desire for acceptance and social inclusion. Especially so as we have seen previously from Desmond's point, that they are neglected and unloved at home. We find that many of them actually turn to mischief, resorting to crime and breaking the rules in a bid to gain acceptance from their peers. We all know what peer pressure is and have probably experienced it in seemingly harmless ways. Hey, after school want to go McDonald's? Ah, losing weight? Just go on time lah. If you have been placed in this situation before, you know how hard it is to say no to others. Thus, similarly, like us, delinquents merely are victims to peer pressure. I know you might be thinking, if somebody asks me to smoke or join a gang with them, it is easy to say no. After all, we are all matured young adults with common sense. But now put yourself in their shoes. You are a secondary school kid placed into a new environment. You have been shown little or no care at home, and you don't have a role model to teach you what is right or wrong. Then comes along your friend, somebody, tells you that if you join a gang with him, there will be a brotherhood there to take care of you, look out for you, and have your back at all times. These two things, easy to say no? This is a phenomenon we know as peer contagion, whereby deviant behavior in one can influence another to act in the same way. In a study conducted by Regis University Criminology Department, they found that peer influence actually had a stronger impact on crime rates than socio-economic factors. So now we must ask ourselves, are delinquents really innately bad, or are they merely victim to societal pressure? Now on to my next point, labeling. Make sure you study hard so you can get into a good school next time. I'm sure all of us have heard this phrase at some point in our lives, whether from our teachers or our parents. Now the fact that schools are labeled as good suggests that there are bad ones as well. And this mindset is troubling, because it sets up a stigma for students who are placed in these supposed bad schools. They are seen as inferior to those who study in better schools, and this may cause them to think, since everyone sees me as a bad student, why do I even bother trying anymore? This is what we know as a self-fulfilling prophecy, whereby people who have labels attached to them are more likely to fall into the very stereotype that categorizes them. Now, even within schools, we have this hierarchy of academics, and we have systems like streaming as well. Schools typically group their classes based on academic results of students. And now, those who are placed at the bottom of the spectrum, they are labeled as being rotten apples, bad students, unfit for studying. And you put 30 people into the same class at the bottom, and we have a problem. Even those who are genuinely willing to try to improve themselves, they are stuck with this label. And no matter what, people will always see them as being unfit for studying. So, we find that labeling is actually a serious problem that drives students to give up on studies and instead turn to delinquency. Unsurprisingly, this problem of labeling is not confined to the limits of a school compound, as Norman will explain further.
Okay, so now I shall be explaining society's role in creating juvenile delinquents. But before I start, has anyone heard of the Big Apple experiment? Nobody. Basically, in 2009, a woman called Nikki Owen, she conducted this experiment by cutting apple into half. Then she placed both halves of the apple in two separate jars, like this. She labeled one jar good and one jar bad. Okay, then, for 25 days, she constantly scolded the apple in the bad jar. And she constantly praised the apple in the good jar. So after 25 days, can anyone guess what happened? Basically, the apple in the bad jar turned out to be like this. However, the apple in the good jar turned out to be like this. Okay, as you all can see, right, it's not really much difference from far, but then from close, right, the bad apple is actually turning moldy, really. So, why am I telling you guys about this experiment? Basically, this experiment sums up what I'm about to say for the next few minutes. And in short, the apples over here, they represent the youths in our society. The more we label them negatively, the worse they get. So, my main idea is that society labels youths, especially youths who have past criminal records or those who have lower education levels, and youths at least succumb to their labels very easily and they fall into delinquency because of that. So one example over here that I'm about to show you, let's take David's example. He's a playful teenager, but just a normal teenager. One day he decides to commit a crime because he's playful, and he goes to a juvenile court trial. So his peers and his relatives, they hear of this and they give him labels like thief and a criminal behind his back. He learns of the labels and he starts losing confidence in himself. And eventually he believes that he's a bad person and he becomes a delinquent. Now many of you may be thinking that this is a slippery slope kind of argument, like it won't happen in real life. But I'm here to show you guys that this actually happens in real life. So this is supported by the labeling theory, which is proposed by Howard Becker. He's a well-known sociologist. He says that society will inevitably label youths through formal and informal acts. Formal acts refer to acts like public caning or like court trials, whereas informal acts refer to things like name calling. And these labels actually have a huge impact on the youth's development. and many youths will succumb to their labels. So this is a survey done in, conducted in Hong Kong. It's regarding the distribution of juvenile crimes in the year 2013. So as we can see, more than half of the juvenile crimes committed that year were actually committed by marginalized youths, who were defined by the survey to be those who had past criminal records and were hence labeled by society. So what we can do to help is not through any big campaigns or any big policies, but we can start by being more mindful of how we act and how we talk towards youths, and also not join in or engage in any name calling or labeling amongst our peers. So to sum up my group's presentation, Desmond earlier mentioned earlier about the lack of familial care and how this lack of care actually results in them turning to gangs in order to find a new home. John mentioned about peer pressure, which actually drives youths to commit crimes in order to fit in the rest. And I just mentioned about societal labeling and how it changes the youth's mindset and makes them believe they're bad people when they're not. So to sum up, we know that it is ultimately the youth's choice as to whether they want to be a delinquent or not. But we also acknowledge that there are many factors pushing youth toward delinquency, and therefore we cannot exactly blame the youth totally for being a delinquent. Therefore, our group believes that juvenile delinquency is a societal issue rather than an individual issue. Thank you.
Questions? Okay, one question for all of you. Firstly, I think good coordination in terms of overall presentation and your points were well articulated. I would like to just talk about one big question to all of you. So you talk about how you should not label. So what does this mean for your project that kind of defines juvenile delinquents as a group in themselves? Does this then undermine your what you're trying to push for? Or do you think that juvenile delinquency is just a phase, or what can we do about
it? You're saying that since we are like targeting delinquents, so we are like actually making the problem even more obvious, right? But actually, our target is more of the people that are just playful. But because of their playfulness, because youths are like, they always want to try new things. So sometimes they make a mistake, and because of that mistake, they get labeled, and this leads them down a path of crime and delinquency. So we are actually targeting the playful youths just before the stage of delinquency, not exactly the delinquents themselves. So in that sense, the youth won't be, since we are targeting the youth themselves, it's not the delinquent that we are targeting. So the youth will not be affected by the bad labels of a delinquent.
For me, I feel differently. I think that people are actually stereotyping a lot based on looks, such as this guy smokes, this guy has tattoos. So he's an abe. Okay. I've been on the receiving end of it. So I know how it feels. So I feel like people should not jump to conclusions so quickly. I mean, there are obviously very clear indicators of being a so-called delinquent, such as you're in gang, stuff like that, or you commit crimes. But I think what we are trying to do is for people to sort of wait before they judge, rather than immediately jumping to conclusions and giving this person like a label, like, oh, you're doing this, therefore you must be a delinquent. And then this guy would just be thinking like, okay, since just cause I'm a smoker or whatever, then everyone thinks I'm an abigan. Why even bother like, even trying to uphold my own self-image? So yeah, that's fine.
Maybe you can just one way to prevent this whole problem is the when you start from the young. So parents definitely play an important role. So I would say that it's the root cause of the problem, because parents without the parents' guidance and the nurturing, close attention from the young age, you really start deviating from this. Not necessarily the best part, but like, go to the delinquent world or something like that. So the labeling can start. You can prevent this whole labeling of juvenile process if you stop. stop it, like curb it right from the start.
Okay, thank you. Make sure you upload your slides.